Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. A very warm welcome to everyone. Today we have a very special guest, Swami Paramananda Saraswati Ji, who is speaking on session 2 of Weekend with Wisdom, titled Undifferentiated Consciousness. Yesterday, Swami Ji was elaborating how Sant Gyaneshwar Maharaj was trying to draw our attention to the source of this absolute knowledge or pure consciousness by making us understand the nature of pure knowledge, which is beyond knowledge or ignorance, both being nothing but thoughts. Swamiji will be continuing today again. Viewers, if you have any question, please post them at the end of the session. Swamiji will be taking up. Swamiji, please start your session.
Hari Om. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwarah, Guru Sakshat Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. We are looking at undifferentiated consciousness. And I was asked a question by someone. Then what is this consciousness? Who can ask this question? Who can ask this question? He who is searching for consciousness as separate to himself. He is still in pursuit of this consciousness through the mind. Mind can only search objectively. And this is the problem that every seeker faces. It's like, but when we were young kids in the school, we used to say, you know, puri Ramayan ho gayi, fir poochte hai ki Ram kaun tha. That means we were looking for consciousness as an object of experience. And if you were attentive yesterday, was that our attempt? Was that the attempt of Gyaneshwar Maharaj, who's established in the self, in the reality? When he's speaking these words, is it his attempt to make you experience, to communicate to you that he has experienced it objectively? Understand this one thing, that when this communication is going on, or Gyaneshwar Maharaj is communicating to us, or when he is writing these verses as commanded by his Guru Maharaj, by his teacher Nivrittinath, he has to communicate and put into finite words that infinite experience. He has to put across that which cannot be put into words. He has to make us understand that which cannot be understood. Understanding being in the mind, which cannot be understood in the mind, by the mind. This is the conundrum that every Guru Maharaj has, every Mahatma has, every teacher has. We go to the ashram, we study, and we study what? We are studying Shankar Bhashya, we are studying yoga, we are doing this, we are doing that, we are studying Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Kundalini Yoga, Kriya Yoga. Then we come to Vedanta. But as long as Vedanta remains in the book, or Vedanta remains in the mind as a thought, what does Vedanta mean? Vedanta mean where the Vedas end. Where the Veda, what are Vedas? They are nothing but words. What are words? Nothing but alphabets. where thoughts conclude, there Vedanta begins. Vedanta is not a concept. Vedanta is not a word. Vedanta is not an idea. Vedanta is our natural state. No, I'm going to Vedantic classes. No, I'm going to study Vedanta. I am a student of Vedanta. I am a practitioner of Vedanta. Who are we fooling? Vedanta cannot be practiced. We are already, what a wave cannot practice being water. It is already water. Nanakotai Maharaj tells somewhere, how much journey does a wave need to traverse? What practices does a wave need to do? How much japa it needs to do? How many Upanishads it needs to read and study and contemplate in order to realize that it is water? I think, I'm sure everyone would have said, nothing it needs to do. It's already water. It doesn't need to do anything. The wave doesn't need to do anything. No practices, because it is already water. How can it gain that which it is already? Same way, what can you as a seeker, what can I as a seeker gain? Or in general, as a seeker, what can we gain? That which we are already. So what is required? Do nothing. But the problem is that we don't know how to do anything. We have the khujli inside to do something all the time. An itch. Which I understood. But then what is consciousness? You want to work it out. Because that's how we have been engaged in this world. To work out our life, to work out our problems, to work out our relationships, to work out our disease. And same, yesterday that was the talk, we mentioned this part. In the same way we are interacting with the world, we are trying to use those same techniques in trying to work out the consciousness. You cannot work out the consciousness. Working out is in the mind. And mind is functioning in the light of consciousness. And that light of consciousness, I am. Be available to it. Be it. This is explained by Jnaneshwar Maharaj in the second verse by a few examples. And Jnaneshwar Maharaj has a plethora of examples. He is never short of examples. One after the other, he'll keep giving examples till it clicks. This is the Amrit Anubhav, this thick book. 70% is examples only. So what does he say? Ka darpanacha nighala aikya bodh pahila mukha bhogi apala apanati. Essentially, initially, the face alone exists, which enjoys the reflection in a mirror through duality to attain the initial essential oneness of. I think we did this yesterday towards the conclusion of the satsang. That the original, when it comes in front of the mirror, then only the reflected face is created, manifested. So you, duality is there, the original and the dual, and the reflected. But because there is the reflected face, you do not become any less. You work on yourself. You continue to be the original. Same thing, because of the because of the phenomena of jiva happen, you have not become less, because there is waking, dream and deep sleep per coming and going. You have not become less. You are still the one. Because out of a man, if husband, brother's son is expressing, he continues to be the man. When that phenomena of husband or brother or son expressed, man has not reduced. And when they go back from where they came, man has not become more. Same way, when the waves have appeared on the ocean, or the ornaments have appeared in the gold, gold has not become less, or water has not become less. And when they merge back into their source, it doesn't increase in volume. Purnamada purnamida. That is our nature. And this you can see even at the relative. I just took the example of man, let it be woman. Let it be water, let it be gold. Similarly, this entire phenomena of waking, dream, deep sleep is continuously happening. Where it is happening? At the mind level. But you, who knows it, that these three are coming and going? Is there someone from outside who's telling you? No. It is your observation. The one who is there, he is other than the waker, dreamer, and the sleeper. He is the eternal one. Keep taking that position. But we choose not to. We choose to be the waker. We choose to be the phenomenal role. And then complain, why this is happening to me? I'm putting all these efforts. I have to do that. Get out of it. Then Jnaneshwar Maharaj says in the next verse, third verse, Jnana ziyatiya pari zagi atmaikya kari. तय सूर्य सूर्य आँखों से सूर्य तय से झाले. Similarly, the pure knowledge functions in the duality to attain non-dual experience. Listen to his words. The pure knowledge functions in the duality to attain non-dual experience. It is something like a knife piercing itself. The knife is piercing itself. It is, in other words, it is the I searching for I. Is that possible? Who am I? You must have heard this, or you must have practiced it also. Who am I? Can you ever come to know? Can your eyes see themselves? Physical eyes, can the eyes see themselves? You know the eye is there, but can the vision ever illuminate the physical eye? Can the mind come to know itself? The mind can call thoughts, because mind is subject object. It can come to know the thought. But can it come to know itself? Can the eye come to know the eye objectively? Is it possible? That is what he tells here, the knife piercing the knife. And thus, Jnaneshwar Maharaj established oneness in spite of manyness. It is like the knife piercing itself. The object is the knife, the piercing object is also the knife, and the sharpness of the knife and the object is one and the same. So we are using so many words, because we have used the words, like a simple example, we have used so many words. The ankle, the bracelet, the necklace, but it's all gold only. We have used the different names as husband and the son and the brother and the etc. But it's the man only. You use the words infinite, nitya, shuddha, buddha, mukta, but it is that pure consciousness only. Now don't go looking for it. Accept. That is where the problem is. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is coming from the position of being it. We are searching for it. Why was Krishna Bhagwan able to speak Bhagavad Gita the way he spoke? Was he the Krishna which Arjuna was knowing? Is that the Krishna who was speaking? So body is there, an individual person called Krishna is sitting in front of Arjuna. But who is speaking? Is it the friend of Arjuna? Is it the individual Krishna? Or is it the infinite being? Because Krishna is ever in poise within himself. So the entire Bhagavad Gita, without any mistakes, no ifs and buts, no because, systematically unfolding from the gross to the subtle to going beyond the causal. And after all that, who can do it? For that, we have to shift our position. When we were studying with Swamiji, our Acharya, he said, when the Bhagavad Gita started with the Shankar Bhashya, he said, don't take the position of Arjuna to study Bhagavad Gita. You will never understand. If you want to let it click, put on the shoes of Lord Krishna. Think from the standpoint that he is thinking. And is he the Nanda Gopal? Is he the Govardhandhari? Is he the various roles that he played? Is he that one, or which Krishna is speaking there? That will become available. You will become available to that knowledge. Similarly, which I are you available to right now? Are you available to the relative I? Virtual I? Are you available to the relative I? Phenomenal I? Or are you available to the absolute one? Because you are at the same, just like the water alone, when you touch the wave, it is water. When you touch the ocean, it is water. And when you touch the water, it is water. When you touch the wave, is your attention on the wave or on the ocean or on the water? When you say I, is your attention on the father, brother, husband, etc.? Or is your attention, I am the body, I am the intellect, I am a yogi, I am a Kriya yogi, I am a Bhakta yogi, I am a Kriya, blah, 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 blah. Or is your I can't even say, use the word attention, or are you in poise as the absolute? We cannot have an objective experience of the pure consciousness. Impossible. And everything that is happening in our life, every moment, nature is pushing us back to our essential nature. At the relative level, the nature is giving ample opportunities, not once in a while. Every moment it is giving the opportunity for us to be to come back, to be in the natural state. All sadhanas that are told in our scriptures are nothing but observation of what we are doing in our life on a daily basis. They are not something special. But we make it into special. Oh, pranayam we have to do. Oh, yoga we have to do. Oh, nididhyasana we have to do. Sharanam mananam nididhyasana we have to do. We have to go into nirvikalpa samadhi. Aren't you going to do nirvikalpa samadhi between two thoughts? Aren't you in nirvikalpa samadhi in sleep? Only you don't know it. That's whose fault? Your fault. What can you do? Anyway, so continuously, when we are between the two thoughts, we are going back to the self. There's nothing there in between the two thoughts. There is absence. Absence is not an object of cognition. Then what is there? There is the undifferentiated consciousness. Do you know it? No, because you are a common man, a seeker. He is wanting an experience. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying, you are there. So many times, nirvikalpa, you're coming back to your original state. Because there are no distractions between the two thoughts. Access it. Increase the gap between the two thoughts. That's why all meditations only bring you to the sandhi between the two. Prana bandhanat leena manasam. And when we bring ourselves in between the two thoughts, there the construct of a thought is not there. There is no conclusion. When there is a thought, there is a conclusion. What is the conclusion? Conclusion of a thought. But between two thoughts, there is no precipitation of any thought. There is no conclusion. There is no vyapti. There is no phala vyapti. So those thoughts which do not lead to phala vyapti, you come to abide. You come to be that pure consciousness. For example, I saw Manu just now. So now I know only two Manus in my life till now. So now either my friend comes or this friend comes. So immediately two forces. But when yesterday I was talking to you about this. When I say, I use the word infinite, what phala vyapti happens? What experience ensues the thought of infinite? What conclusion happens in your mind when you contemplate on or you think about birthless? What conclusion you come to that self is self-effulgent, self-knowing? No conclusion. Wherever there is phala vyapti, there is precipitation of individuality. Individual alone is a seeker. Get out of that. Start accepting. Start accepting. For that, now again, he gives more examples. That when we keep contemplating on the I, we keep contemplating on I as the infinite, as the nitya, as the one without a second. Our focus, as Ramana Maharishi says, who am I? Yes, we have to begin there, but it is not going to lead to any conclusion. Realization is not a conclusion. But what is happening in that process? Because there is nothing called realization. Then what is happening in that process? When this contemplation on our essential nature gets triggered by the grace, by certain practices, when it happens, then it starts destroying all the ajnana vritti. All the thoughts which take us away from the self, from the natural state, they start getting consumed. Why? Because we are attentive of the the self, the I, the pure I. It's only a thought at the moment. But this thought, as we said yesterday, it is able to counteract all the other thoughts. And how long will it continue? As long as there is something to consume. How long we have to keep thinking of sleep? As long as there is some thought of the waking. You're not removing the waking thoughts from your mind. You're thinking of sleep thought in your mind. We are thinking of the I. Full attention. Knowing that it cannot be known. Because I am that. But why am I not having abiding in it then? Because there are other thoughts coming and disturbing. So I keep contemplating till the data of not I thoughts, in other words, ajnana vritti, gets consumed completely. For that, he gives one example, just like the camphor. Agi pota sa cheni me se apan pe zali le jaise jnana jnana nashe taise jale. Having burnt the camphor, the fire dies itself. Similarly, having destroyed the ignorance, knowledge also disappears. So, can you have fire without camphor? No. So when the camphor is lit, the fire is blazing. What is the fuel for the fire? The camphor. How long will the fire glow? Continue to burn? As long as even a last bit of camphor is there, the fire will be there. And when the entire fuel is consumed, then what will happen to the fire? The fire will also go away. Exactly the same way, this jnana vritti, it continues blazing as long as, in simple words, am brahmasmi thought or who am I thought. It will keep blazing as long as there is ajnana vritti as the fuel. And when that fuel has exhausted, then there's no need to say, I am, to say, I am Brahman, to say anything, then you just are without a thought. And how does it destroy itself? Here he says in the next verse, Ajnana chatenka nasata hi jnana adhika. With the destruction of ignorance, the knowledge increases to such an extent that this increase leads to its own destruction. If you have seen a candle burning, when its moment, last moment comes, or if you have been doing the Karpur Aarti, when the last moment comes, last bit of fear, suddenly the flame becomes very bright. It had been burning steadily, but when the last moment comes, it burns, it increases in volume, it increases in brightness, and then khalas, then vanishes. What vanishes? When we are contemplating on who am I or who is this I, what am I, where am I? When you are asking who am I, you have a doubt. That's why you are asking. You don't know your original self. So you are asking who am I? Because you have been considering yourself to be body, breath, mind, intellect. Father, brother, daughter, sister, whatever, different things. Now slowly, in that intense fire of contemplation of who am I or your true nature, everything else is burning away, burning away, burning away. And when the last bit is there, there's a sudden flare up and it exhausts. What exhausts? The flame goes away. It says here, the camphor finishes, the flame goes away. So ignorance goes away, the knowledge also goes away. Knowledge is what? The vritti. When you are contemplating on aham, it is vritti aham. And when ignorance burns away completely, then what goes away? The vritti aspect of the aham drops away. Then what remains? Vritti rahit aham. That is pure consciousness. That is your natural state. That is you who have, we are saying it. Why? We have to communicate. So I'm using these words. After some time, I might use some other word. This is just a prakriya. Continuing, he says, he gives quite a few examples now, few examples of the growth and destruction of knowledge. He tells how this growth and destruction of knowledge comes about through examples. I'll just read the examples. The increase in the knowledge before its destruction is similar to that of extra brightness of the flame just before its extinction, which I just explained to you. Then he says, another example he gives, and that is the fullness of growth of breasts of a woman itself leads to their drooping. Another example gives that the full blooming of a flower is itself the start of its drying. Anything created, destruction has started. You may be celebrating birthdays, but actually you're moving towards death, destruction. Same way, another example, the formation of the waves is the beginning of its submission in the ocean, or the appearance of the lightning is its disappearance. See the idea, understand the principle. Understand what is, where the Jnaneshwar Maharaj is taking our attention to. Don't get lost in the example. Examples are many, but the principle that he is in trying to hone us into. So, concluding this example, he says, Taise piyuni ajnana tava vari vadhe jnana zava apule nidhana nishesha sadhe. In the same way, Jnaneshwar Maharaj says, the knowledge grows on the diet of ignorance to such an extent that it leads to its own disappearance. The flame grows on the diet of camphor only to exhaust itself. Only to exhaust itself. One moment. I need to put something. In order to exhaust itself. So as long as there is, food of Ajnana Vritti, that till then the Jnana Vritti will continue to burn. If there is no fuel left, then there is no need for Jnana Vritti also. And this is happening to you every day when you go to sleep. Bringing our attention again, this example he takes many times. When we go to sleep, we do not push the world out of our mind. If you try to push the world out of your mind, you will have a sleepless night. Instead, what do? You become focused on the thought of the sleep and you keep thinking of sleep. And how long will you keep thinking of sleep? Till the thought or all thoughts other than the sleep have not exhausted, have not been consumed by the thought of the sleep. That is the fear. And when the last thought other than the sleep thought is consumed as the fuel, then what happens? For that, you don't know. Every night when that happens, you are snoring away. Make it happen consciously. Do the japa, do the contemplation, chant om, and come to that point. And don't go to sleep, then you will find out what happens. So when ajnana vritti is exhausted, consumed, then the jnana vritti also dies its own death. Then you don't need to keep on inquiring, who am I, who am I? You don't have to. You have to only inquire, who am I, till you have got other distractions. So this jnana vritti is invoked to counteract the ajnana vritti, and eventually when it has eaten up all the ajnana vritti, then it also dies, and what remains if you have not come to the answer, it's you, the pure consciousness. And this is happening to us many times during the day. As Jnaneshwar Maharaj says, ajnana is incomplete knowledge. Between every two thoughts, this is happening to us. We want it continuously, whether there are thoughts or no thoughts. Again, few more examples Jnaneshwar Maharaj says. The waters of the great deluge engulf both the oceanic waters and the land so as not to allow any differences between water and land. You have a well because there is a hole in the land. There is a pond because the pond is surrounded by land. Without land, you cannot have a pond or a lake or a river or a dam. It needs some perimeter. But there is water in the lake, there is water in the well, there is water in the pond, there is water in any container, any type of water, in the river. But when the deluge takes place, when the floods come, when the pralaya comes, like the tsunami came, as far as you can see, it's water, water everywhere. What happened to the land? Can't see. What happened to the lakes? Can't see them. What happened to the ponds and rivers and the wells? They lose their independent existence. Now everything is covered by water. Exactly the same way, Bhagwan says, Jnaneshwar Maharaj also says that the ignorance, so water and land was creating all these different puddles and lakes and everything. Knowledge and ignorance both are covered, are in the deluge of the pure consciousness. Nothing else remains but the pure consciousness. And that pure consciousness is also a name that we have given to the reality. You cannot call it reality also. We don't need to call ourselves by any name. If we don't have a name, we still exist, don't we? If there is no one to call you brother, if there is no one to call you son, if there is no one to call you teacher, if there is no one to call you man or woman, there is no one to call you a seeker or a you still continue to exist, don't you? If you don't have anyone to communicate to also. You communicate a common person. When I come to India, which is almost every year, not last one and a half year, but invariably, they ask only one question. Swamiji, which ashram do you belong to? Which parampara you are from? What is your name of your organization? When did you take your sannyas? How long you have been on this line? How long you have been on this line? Line of what? See? Now, are these the questions to be asked to a sannyasi? Or should a sannyasi be asking these questions to anyone? Then he is not a sannyasi. He is not a seeker then. But this has become a fashion. Which organization? Acha, you don't have any organization. You don't belong to anything. Which religion? All religion. Acha? You are fooling us. How can you fool a fool? And holding on to all their identities. I am a seeker. I am a Vedanti. I am a from this ashram, I am from that ashram, I am a disciple of this guru. They want to seek the pure consciousness that is infinite. Understand, all these things happen. We also went through that. But here the topic is undifferentiated consciousness. Here the topic is the experience of a great master and his words of realization. Understand the context also. Another example is saying, the initial waking up may be called as destruction of sleep, but thereafter, during the waking state, there is waking alone without reference to sleep. Huh? Similarly, initially, the jnana vritti is under the influence of ajnana vritti. I is a slave of aham, is a slave of idam. Slowly, slowly, aham becomes independent. It is not thinking about idam. That's when the consummation of idam begins, the exhaustion of idam begins. When you wake up in the morning, every morning you wake up. I hope you wake up. I'm sure you wake up. For maybe a second or two, some remnants of the dream may be lingering. But very next moment, 5 seconds, 10 seconds, half a minute, if you ask, someone asks, what did you do? You can't remember anything. Similarly, this I was associating, it was propping itself up from the with the reference of idam, the ajnana vritti. It was associating itself with the not I and propping itself up. Who are you? I am a husband. Husband is, I has decided it is a husband because of associating with a wife. I am a father of 3 kids. I has associated with the 3 kids and with their reference, it's saying I am the father of 3 kids. oh, I was born on this day. Oh, the reference is the birth of the body when the day it came, and that is only a piece of paper. Who knows what is the truth? And then people say, oh, these are your parents, and the son is born. Reference, who are you? I am the son of these parents. So this I is dependent. It is enslaved by all these references. Till it discovers that it is giving, it is all by itself. It doesn't need any reference in order to be. That's when it comes to the Shastras. Then gurus come into that person's life. Then the interest to know the self ignites. So what happens? This jnana vritti slowly becomes stronger and stronger, and eventually it itself disappears, and there is knowledge. And when that flame disappears, then there is knowledge, but there is no thought of the knowledge. This is called, there is no vritti vyapti, or there is no phala vyapti. The I continues, but without a thought of I. That is undifferentiated consciousness, that I am. It doesn't require any reference point. It is self-abiding, self-knowing, self-effulgent. Be that. You are that all the time. Only imagining yourself not to be so. Shift. Accept. Right now, as a seeker, I don't know anyone of you there, but if the question was asked, what is consciousness? Again, I'm repeating, this question is because we want to have an experience of consciousness, like I have experience of this glass of water. I want to, no, this is water. It quenches my thirst. I want to be at peace. I want to be in tranquility. I want to be in meditation. Undifferentiated consciousness is not that consciousness which comes and goes. It's ever the same, the constant one. And that is you. This is what Parikshit Maharaj realized after having listened to 7 days of lectures on Bhagavat by Shukdev Ji Maharaj. He did not do any sadhana. He was attentive. I told you this yesterday. He was attentive. He heard single-pointedly, full devotion and surrender, knowing the ensuing death, the Takshak is going to come and bite him. And that's why he went there. Is there a solution for this? Yes, there is. Have we come to that point? Are we just having an intellectual exercise, or are we sincerely wanting a solution? Enough of this waking dream deep sleep. Let me wake up once and for all. Has it caught us from inside? Otherwise, we are just shunting from one scripture to another scripture, from next to next scripture, appreciating this. Scriptures don't need our validation. Scriptures must be studied, interacted with, so that we vanish. We get completed. not complete the scripture. I have studied this Upanishad, I have studied Bhagavad, I have studied yoga. I know this master, I know that Mahatma, you know, I did so much seva with him. He doesn't need you. You did seva to sing your glories, or you did seva to purify and merge. You study, come across scriptures so that you become, your eye becomes thinner and thinner and thinner. Or your ego that I have studied this, I can give lecture on this, I know the Bhagavad Gita by heart from beginning till end, blah, 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 and so on. Is that why we are studying the scriptures? From the point of view of absolute, there is no existence of knowledge and ignorance. This is the point, and now again, you will take a few examples. There is unlimited number of examples by Jnaneshwar Maharaj. What is the time? 2:30, 3:30, 4 o'clock. He says, Te veli puniva bhare na avasa sare te chandrichi ure sataravi zevi. The moon has neither the fullness of a full moon night or the total absence of dark night. So neither the moon is a full moon nor it is a no moon. Moon is moon. You are seeing the phenomena of full moon or no moon. From moon's point of view, there is no full moon or no moon. And what it is? It is the 17th one beyond the 16 phases. 16 starting from full moon to no moon. And the 17th one is the original one. Likewise, in pure knowledge, there is neither knowledge nor ignorance. I don't know if you care. Just like from your point of view, there is day and night. From sun's point of view, there is neither day, neither the day nor the night. From sun's point of view, there is no light and there is no darkness. But for us, day, yeah, the day is the waking. Waking removes tamas. Waking removes the nidra, alasya, pramad is removed by invocation of the sattva. Sattva is light. Sattva is knowledge. Knowledge removes doubts and confusions. Where is this dialogue going on? In the mind. And who are you? Do you know this dialogue is going on? Yeah. Then the one who knows must be other than other than it, isn't it? Now, having given these examples, Jnaneshwar Maharaj, so where are these 16 kalas of the moon existing? From no moon to full moon or full moon to no moon? Where are these existing? Are they actually there? They are existing in their own absence from the moon's point of view. Where is the day and night existing from the sun's point of view? It's existing in its own absence. Where are all the waves and the oceans existing from the water's point of view? They are existing in their own absence. There is nothing like ocean and wave from the absolute water standpoint. Have we come to that? That in spite of being in this world, we are one. Do we still give validity to the differences in the world? Then we are far, far, far away from that undifferentiated consciousness, even though we are not far away from it. we imagine ourselves to be far away because we have given validity to the differences. You cannot remove the differences. You have to accept that you are the one. Accept. You have accepted yourself to be the husband or the wife. You have accepted you are the body. You have accepted you are the mind. You have never seen the mind, but you have accepted you are the mind. You had accepted I cannot live without my toys. Now you say I cannot live without my wife and children. When will you come to this point that I am? I am me. Full stop. When will you accept that you are the all-encompassing principle? It's only a question of acceptance. And then living. And letting that principle express. Mahatmas are living like that. From the disposition of undifferentiated consciousness, knowledge. Now Jnaneshwar Maharaj in the 16th OV, he calls it OV rather than verse in his language. How impossible it is to describe the pure knowledge by comparing it to something else. So here he says, काते जातरे नाटोपे कोणे तमे नसिंपे ते उपमेचे राउपे सूर्यची होए. The sun, independent of any other source of light and immune to the presence of darkness, is incomparable to anything else but itself. Is there any orb within the vicinity of this solar system which can compare to the sun? Can anything illuminate the sun? The sun himself is the heat. The sun himself is the light. Yet he doesn't know heat and light as separate from him, so he cannot talk about it. If you ask him, thank you for the heat, thank you for the light, he says, what is that? I don't know. Thank you for the day, thank you for the night. He says, I don't know what you're talking about. From sun, here the sun is taken as the absolute. So it cannot be compared. There is no upama out there. Not the suji upama. There is no comparison with which the absolute can be compared. Then what can be the pure knowledge be compared to? It can only be compared to itself. There is nothing like it. It is the only one. Ekameva dvitiya. The pure knowledge is such that neither is it brightened by knowledge nor is it darkened by ignorance beyond any denial in knowledge and ignorance. So where is knowledge and where is ignorance? At the mind level. Where is day and night? At the earth plane. Go outside the earth's plane, there is no day and there is no night. Go into the space, there is no day and no night. Go to the sun, he says, I don't even know what it is. If you have to imagine these type of scenarios, it will help us. That's why he's giving us the examples. The pure knowledge is such that neither is it brightened. So there na tatra suryo bhati na chandra tarakam nema vidyato bhanti kuto yam agnih tameva bhantam anubhati sarvam tasya bhasa sarvam idam vibhati. Na tatra suryo bhati na chandra tarakam. There is no light. What is this pure consciousness? It is that which cannot be illuminated by any other objective source of light. We are not talking light only about bulb. Even a thought is a light for that matter. Na tatra suryo bhati na chandra. These are the few sources of light. So nothing can brighten it, nor anything can darken it. Nothing can cover the sun. Oh, but we see eclipse. You see it. Sun doesn't see the eclipse. Sun doesn't see the eclipse. Similarly, appearance of the thoughts and disappearance of the thoughts does not affect the constant conscious principle that I am. The appearance of thoughts, knowledge. The disappearance of thought, ignorance, if you want to put it that way. Presence of thoughts and absence of thoughts. And who am I? Transcendental to both. Presence of thought and absence of thought are the phenomena. Where is the phenomena taking place? In the mind. Where is the mind existing in its own absence? And that you have taken to be real and living your life accordingly. Isse bada buddhu kon hoga? So when masters like this write, it is like a mirror. They are showing us who we really are. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is communicating. How wonderful it is. So because this pure self, the pure consciousness, the undifferentiated consciousness cannot be compared with anyone, it cannot be illumined by anyone, it cannot be covered by anything or anything, anything. Now there is a problem. Problem, imagine problem for us because we are still seekers. And what is the problem? Then how do we remove this? But we only know how to think. We are processing everything through thinking, through thoughts. So how do I remove the objectification of the self? How do I remove it? How can this pure knowledge, where subject-object differentiation has not taken place, be known objectively as the eye cannot see itself? And for this, he gives a few examples again. Can the space enter itself, or the fire burn itself, or a person ride on his own head? Three examples it is. See, even if you read Jnaneshwar Maharaj's Bhagavad Gita, every verse, innumerable number of examples. Can the space enter the space? I entered into my room space. Can, when the house is destroyed, the walls are destroyed, the house space, does it enter the total space? Question. When the wave dies, does it enter the waters or merge into waters? Or was it already water? Or was it an entryless entry, mergingless merging? Second example. Can, or the fire burn itself? Is it possible for the fire to burn itself? And third one, a person rides on his own head. How can you ride on your own head? An impossibility. Just as impossible it is for the space to enter space, water to enter water, wave to enter water, or for fire to burn itself, or the person to ride on his own head, that much. Again, more examples, okay. Can the vision see itself, or the taste itself, or the sound hear itself? Is it possible? These things have to be immediately, don't collect information. Right here and now, apply it. Can the, I gave this example, bro. Can our eyes see themselves? No. Yet the knowledge of eye is there. You have not seen them. You are not seeing them, yet you know they are there. Then why do we need an objective experience of the self in order to be the self? Can the taste or the taste itself or the sound hear itself? All of these are impossibilities. More examples. Does the sun illumine the sun, or the fruit fructify for itself, or the smell itself? All the panch indriyas are taken, and some other examples. So the sun is not illumining the sun. It is not. Its nature is that. Or the fruit fructifies for itself. Is the fruit becoming ripe for itself? And also now the smell, which is the Ghranendriya. Okay. Can the smell itself? The point that is being made here is, kaise apanaya apana zanate nave zana manavni jnana pane vina jnana matraze. The pure consciousness or the pure knowledge or the undifferentiated knowledge or this atma tattva cannot come to know itself objectively. It cannot have experience of itself. Therefore, this pure knowledge is the knowledge without the difference of knower and known. If this is the case, that this pure self, this undifferentiated self, is that where the knower known difference is absent, then what is your sadhana then while living? Don't become a knower. Let seeing happen, don't become a seer. Let hearing happen, don't become a hearer. Let experience happen, don't become an experiencer. Let observation happen, don't become an observer. Let waking happen, don't become a waker. Dream happen, don't become a dreamer. Sleep happen, don't become a sleeper. All these roles that you have taken, they are the errors formed due to identification with the object. Don't allow them to precipitate. This is how Mahatmas live. This is how our Maharishis lived. This is how Nisargadatta Maharaj lived. This is how all the Gondavlekar Maharaj, Neem Karoli Baba, Anandamayi Ma, all the great masters, Ramakrishna Paramhams, all of them lived in this manner. And this is possible for you, me, everyone. But we have to accept that we are the one. I am the one. Aham Brahmasmi, you have to accept. Not blindly, with understanding. Correctly. not objectively, but subjectively. So in this manner, Jnaneshwar Maharaj says, everything else that is there, other than this pure self, this pure knowledge, this pure consciousness, this undifferentiated consciousness, this other than this one who is all that there is. This is for the seeker. It is your imagination. If the thoughts, I know, I think I am Brahman, I think I have reached, I think I am there, I think it's clicked. Ooh, such a great ecstasy. Pulling yourself, still in the mind. It was so silent, it was so wonderful. Swamiji, can we continue the meditation? I lost the plot. Whether you, the pure consciousness is not corrupted by happening of meditation or coming and going of Jagrat, Swapna, Sushupti, Samadhi. It is not corrupted by it. Those are conditions of the mind. Pure consciousness, undifferentiated consciousness continues to be the one as it is. It is all that there is. There's nothing else other than it. And that I am, in essence. But we are lost in experiences of the mind. Samadhi is an experience of the mind, as much as waking, dream, and deep sleep are. Get out of it. Initially, it is necessary, but then you must move ahead, not stop at Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Move on from there. Something in our life, just like it is a natural unfoldment of our abilities from the time we are born. We are increasing our ability. We learn how to walk, we learn how to talk, we learn how to eat, we learn how to speak, we learn how to read, we learn how to do mathematics, English, Hindi, Sanskrit, and somewhere along the line when we doing all this like a mechanically by grace of God, we come to the satsang. Now our different journey begins and we start moving in this direction. In that yoga or whatever path you have chosen, it leads you to dharana, dhyana, samadhi. Growth, you're moving, you're maturing. And if you have come to this point of samadhi, where you are going into samadhi, ecstasy. Come out of samadhi, dextasy. Yeah? Problems. There's no word like that, I just coined it. But there again, some samadhi, I want to go into samadhi, I have come out of samadhi, I have got to go into samadhi, I have to come out. The world is still present there after you come out. Is there, what will be the natural consequence, next consequence? If you have grown up till this point, till Nirvikalpa Samadhi, what will be the next? Jnaneshwar Maharaj used to sit in samadhi just by nama jap. Vaikari Madhyama Pashyanti Para used to be in samadhi. What's the next step? What is the natural? What will be the next question that comes? It will only come when you become aware that you are into a pattern of going into meditation, coming out of meditation, going into meditation, coming out of meditation. What's the next consequence? What's the next growth? What's the next possibility? Is there a way that I can remain in that undifferentiated consciousness continuously whether I'm in meditation or outside meditation, isn't it? Samadhi happened because you accepted emptying the mind as being the consciousness. That's why you want to run away from the world into meditation. Still, things have not resolved completely. You can stay for years together in Nirvikalpa. But when you come out, again the world is there. I met one person in Haridwar when I was living there. He had come from Tibet somewhere as a young child. One Mahatma met him and he asked the Mahatma, "Can you teach me Nirvikalpa Samadhi?" He said, "Come." He took him to Tibet in his cave. He says, "Tell me, what did you want?" "I want Nirvikalpa Samadhi." Somewhere this kid must have heard. He touched his head. 6 years this boy was in Nirvikalpa Samadhi. And one day he came out of Samadhi. Why? Because the sankalpa of his teacher was becoming weak because he was dying of old age. And when I met him, it had been already 4 or 5 years since he had come back from Tibet. He says, "Swamiji, from the day my teacher has gone away, I have not even one day been able to sit in Samadhi. It was all by his grace." So things like this can happen, but that is not our goal. Our goal is the natural state. Our goal is the pure consciousness. Our goal, that which cannot be removed. Our goal is that which cannot be removed. You can remove everything. You can remove the relatives. You can remove the world. You can remove what you see here, touch, feel, taste. You can remove your thoughts. Can you remove yourself? That which cannot be removed, understand its true nature. It's all that there is. It is not corrupted by knowledge or ignorance. Just like sun is not corrupted by heat or light. Just like the moon is not corrupted by the 16 colors. Just like the water is not corrupted by the ocean and waves. Accept this about ourselves, that I am not corrupted by any damn thing in this world. The whole world being nothing but my mind, but this mind. Practice equanimity. Begin somewhere. Because it is our natural state. Naturally, you are attracted to it. You want to be it. But if you are seeking it objectively, then keep taking birth after birth after birth, and there is no end to it. We'll conclude here. And in this manner, Jnaneshwar Maharaj, he has one more thing that before I conclude, one more thing is that Jnaneshwar Maharaj has addressed here is a doubt. And what is the doubt? Jnaneshwar himself is thinking of the, because he's writing and the doubt must have come or the thought must have appeared. So he says, "Taise asane ani nasane he nahi zaya hone आता मिथ्या ऐसे येने बोले गमे." He says, the pure knowledge can be called as neither existent or non-existent. Yesterday, when we began the satsang, what did we say? The words sat, chit, anand are in one way abuses to that reality. Sat is used to cancel, counteract, neutralize asat. Chit is used to counteract, neutralize achit. And anand is used to counteract dukkham. So these are only words to counteract, just like the jnana vritti was to counteract the ajnana vritti. Similarly, the jnana vritti here is sat, chit, anand, and it takes care of whatever the opposite is, asat, achit, dukkha. The pure knowledge that I am is neither. It cannot be called as existent or non-existent. Neither knowledge nor ignorance. The student is saying, okay, but if someone has a problem to this statement that it cannot be called as existent or non-existent, and comes to conclude, what is the conclusion? That pure knowledge is an illusion or nothingness. Nyaneshwar Maharaj is saying, don't come to this conclusion. You are going the wrong way in your thinking again. It is not nothing. So he says, if this doubt is coming, he replies, tarika hi nahi sarvatha, I see zari vyavastha, tari nahi he pratha, kavana sipa. He says the answer to this objection, if someone is making it, is who is making this inquiry about the nothingness? If you are saying that the pure knowledge is an illusion or nothingness, who is making this statement? Statement cannot happen by itself. Someone has to be there. Someone is speaking here. And this thought I have already mentioned, that the presence, the pure consciousness, is transcendental to presence and absence. Absence is nothing but nothingness. Many people, they focus on the void and then get all scared on in the seat of meditation and come back shivering. Our goal is not void. We are not void. We are not nothing. We cannot call ourselves that we are something also. But we are. We are all that there is, in essence. He says, in whose presence the knowledge or nothingness has been established. Without this presence, the absence cannot be established. So there is presence of thought and there is absence of thought. Who is knowing that there is a thought, presence of thought? Who is knowing that there is now absence of thought? When I am speaking, when I make this statement, this sentence, when I am speaking. So, when I am speaking, four words I spoke. These four words were presence of thought. Between those two words, when and I and am and speaking, there was gap. There was absence of thought. Do you know Yes, I know there was nothing there. Who knows? If you say, I know there was nothing, who knows? You cannot remove that one. You are that. All you have to do is come to know what. That is all that there is. When we collect information about that through thoughts, it is incomplete knowledge. Nyaneshwar Maharaj calls it ignorance. Ignorance means incomplete knowledge. When I know that in spite of the thoughts, then it is complete knowledge. When I am in spite of the presence of the thoughts or absence of the thoughts, that is pure, undifferentiated consciousness or knowledge or self. That full stop. And in this manner, our Nyaneshwar Maharaj really thrills us every Sunday morning. We are continuing on this chapter and it will go on, maybe 2-3 years it will continue every Sunday. And so this was just a snippet over the 2 satsangs by the grace of Advaita Academy. And I thank them for giving me the opportunity. And I wish you all the best. Hari Om.
Thank you, Swamiji, for that wonderful session. Thank you so much. From the entire team of Advaita Academy, we thank you immensely for agreeing to do these wonderful shows for the past 2 days. I think all of our viewers have been very benefited from these lessons. Thank you once again. So viewers, with this, we conclude the session. We will be soon posting the recordings on our YouTube channel and also Facebook. Please follow on our social media platforms. With this, we will conclude the session. Sri Guru Bhyo Namaha.
Mari.